How does a card-carrying Marxist and strident anti-monarchist become an overnight enthusiast of the British royal family? The answer is embodied by washed-up British demagogue and closeted Muslim, George Galloway, whose newfound interest in the conjugal affairs of Buckingham Palace came about because of Meghan Markle's racial makeup. Mixed-race romanticism has come a long way in the UK, and now it's a phenomenon far deeper than just the contortionist genuflections of white knights before Nubian nuptials. In theatre and cinema, where all fairy tales come to life, diversity is being peppered in at unprecedented levels, with peculiar focus on casting coloured people in the roles of white historical figures. The concept of the Black Viking, once referred to in jest, is now a casting couch formality for major production houses. It's certainly no coincidence that in Thor, Idris Elba was thought optimal for the role of Heimdall, known amongst the Norse as the whitest of all gods. Or take the BBC television series Merlin, for which no better candidate than Guyanese-English actress Angel Colby could be found for the lead role of Guinevere, whose Welsh etymology, Gwynwifar, means fair or white enchantress. Colorblind casting stopped being progressive somewhere around the turn of the century, and in its place, color-conscious policies became the norm. Prefaced, of course, by Marxian platitudes about the need to be inclusive and represent the changing face of Britain. In reality, color-conscious casting is a vindictive act of domination and humiliation. This is how the establishment trolls, in the real world and right in your face. Of course, executives would never dare engage in race bending for any significant, non-white historical figure like Martin Luther King, Gandhi, or Confucius. And yet the BBC pretends that whitewashing in Hollywood is the greater problem. The BBC simply commissions their social justice surgeons to perform a race lift on almost all of their productions of European epics and historical reenactments. This year's blockbuster miniseries, Troy, Fall of a City, is set in the 13th century BC, but producers dunked Ghanaian Briton David Gyasi into Troy's melting pot as Achilles anyway, while Nigerian-born Hakim K. Kazim was anointed for the role of king of the god Zeus in what is now a long-running tradition of blacks portraying oracles or gods of infinite wisdom. Nothing is sacred anymore, and that includes the memory of 15th-century martyr and saint Joan of Arc, whose latest incarnation on Broadway features black American Condola Rashad in the lead role. Meanwhile, in France, protesters are certainly aware of the lineage and legacy of Joan of Arc. Her statue in Paris was recently used as a guilt totem by the Black African Defense League. The group blamed the country of Joan of Arc for the fact that widespread slavery had returned to Libya. Though why these Black African defenders are stationed in France to begin with remains a mystery. The upcoming 2018 Robin Hood remake will feature the sassy Jamie Foxx as Little John, apparently because scriptwriters have turned Robin's right-hand man into a Moorish commander, because for liberals, robbing from the culturally rich and giving to the culturally poor in the name of inclusivity is a perfunctory gesture, and the comical character upgrades add some stimulating flair to their normie vision experience. For decades, blacks have demonstrated an indecorous readiness to take these handouts, being underprivileged in heritage and history as they are. Authentic black history from the homeland is confined to oral incantations of trivial tribal conflicts and animistic parables. Their real history begins with the arrival of the white and Semitic civilizations, which, understandably, skews their storied inheritance toward one of inequity and tragedy. As a result, many turn to surrogate histories that are deeper and more affirmative, no matter how untrue. Take the Black Israelites, the Black Athena movement, or Wakanda, for example. But this affirmation is increasingly turning into aggression, as blacks and their allies give white male statues and paintings their eviction notice, while LARPing power fantasies as founding fathers in the hip-hop musical Hamilton. With the Kulturschraum thoroughly permeated by diversity politics and miscegenation fetishism, more formal institutions for social engineering are pushing a rather subversive program of empirical distortion and slick propaganda. Universities are replete with activist scientists, because most dissident scientists standing on the wrong platform don't get to board the tenure and grants gravy trains. Take this year's Cheddar Man saga, for example, politically motivated agitprop if there ever was. The transracial mugshot spread like wildfire in the mass media, while the scientific backpedaling that followed rolled in the tumbleweed. The claims were total conjecture due to key genetic loci missing from the data. But the project's carefully managed fermentation succeeded in its ulterior purpose of yet more undermining of British identity and furthering the idea that whites are not indigenous to anything. Just how many people are falling for the junk science and historical revisionism cannot be known, but it's only likely going to grow in appeal for the rapidly increasing mixed-race population in migrant communities, some of whom have cognitive dissonance about their role in Britain's changing face. Meanwhile, white children too are being fed blackwashed visions of Britain's history, thanks once more to the BBC, as well as to the overhauled school syllabus. This isn't just changing the fabric of society, it's excavating the bedrock, and every tool of propaganda will be harnessed. Imperial rump states like France and the UK have now become such dire advertisements for colonial blowback and simmering discord that defining moments on the world stage have come to be characterized as bringing relief rather than ecstasy. Everyone from the police to the lunch lady have to walk on eggshells lest prison riots or another round of London riots resume over some drug dealer of color who is shot. State propaganda will continue to stream diversity soapies and symphonies for all the open-minded naivete that is left to be harvested from whites. But for minorities, appeasement really isn't necessary at this point. They are not here for a seat at the round table, nor to partake in the curation of English folklore, Norse mythology, or French cuisine, nor to rally around a communal soccer trophy. Mosques are springing up all over Western Europe, now even brazenly named for the invaders who previously failed to conquer the continent, such as the gruesome Faustian fulfillment of Western multiculturalism and multitolerantism. There is no multi-anything in the long run, just absorption or replacement. The enfeeblement of Europeans' pedigree and their civilization follow like a horse and carriage, and once complete, all that will remain of the European man is a mule-like economic unit without any cultural significance, while African immigrant matchmaking for Western women will be a primary prerogative of liberal democracies. Thus, not only will European man be erased from the sweep of history, during this process, he will be kept in check as a hardy but docile beast of burden, sterile both racially and politically, while toiling for the excesses of hostile foreign masters. Staring at a gray sky.